Welcome to this small talk on which is part of the series of talks on right-based approach to welfare, organized by the research unit on local self-government of the Center for Development Studies, Trivandrum. Thank you, Devika, for inviting me to this particular talk. I'll be talking basically on nature in the context of people's democracy in Kerala. In this particular context, when I'm speaking right now, we are all in lockdown, and the lockdown has been extending for quite some time. It has crossed 3 months as of now, and the general perception on nature during the period of lockdown is that the nature has come back in a big way. Pollution has declined. The air is much more cleaner. The water is cleaner. Animals have started to move out to even to cities. So that's a general perception which the newspapers and the television channels are communicating. We had a much more closer look at this particular scenario. There was an article from the Scientific American which said that most of this news were fake about the dolphins in Italy or the long distance sighting of the Himalayas. But then there were some cases in which animals were spotted much beyond their home ranges. It's true that when the human activity has come down, the animals may have expanded their home range a bit. We did a small study as part of, not just because of the lockdown, but then we had been recording the soundscape of our campus for a long time now. And we closely observed the soundscape before the lockdown and during the lockdown, and which basically means that we are capturing the sounds, three types of sounds. One is the sound produced by nature, like the rain, the thunder, lightning, flowing rivers, and all, which we normally call as the geophony. And then the sounds produced by living organisms, like insects, birds, mammals, etc., which we call as the biophony, and also the sound produced by human machines, like the siren of the ambulances, the sirens from the industries, the sound of the vehicle, the air conditioner, the fan, everything. So we classify the soundscape into three: the sounds produced by the planet, which is the geophony; the other produced by the living organisms, the biophony; and the third, the sound produced by our own machines, which is called as the anthropophony. So what we observed was there's a lowering of anthropophony, but when we closely looked at biophony, there was no big difference. There had been a slight difference in the timings of the insects mostly, but then on the whole, we cannot say that there's a big difference which has happened. But it's very sure that there's a big difference in the way in which the abiotic factors have behaved. The amount of carbon dioxide pushed into the atmosphere has gone down. And the current estimate is that when people compared the carbon dioxide emission during the month of April across 2 years, 2019 and 2020, there was a 17% decline in the amount of carbon dioxide which has gone to the atmosphere this year. And it would be much more higher because when we compare the other months, both before and after April. So there's a difference in, there's a big decline in the amount of carbon dioxide which is thrown up into the atmosphere. But then we should remember that the Paris Agreement had suggested bringing down the carbon dioxide emissions, and the amount of carbon which has been lowered right now has not reached the level at which we had agreed in the Paris Agreement. So it's a long road to go. And once the lockdown is lifted, everything is going to come back. So I personally don't feel that this lockdown has got a very big impact on nature, and it's coming up in a big way. And also there are stories from Africa which comes as totally negative to this particular story. In Africa, what has happened is that the cities have locked down, and the people are moving, the laborers are moving back to their villages. And when they reach the villages, they need to have other occasions to survive. And the bushmeat has been tremendously used. Deforestation is happening. So the lockdown, which is induced by the pandemic, has been very negative for the environment in many parts of the globe. It is very case specific, country specific. There are positive cases in some places, there are absolute negative cases in other places. What we are going to discuss now is how biodiversity is related to the whole system of pandemic. As we know, the pandemic originated from a organism which is not clearly identified. It could be a pangolin, it could be a bat, but it is very sure that the virus is very close to the viruses which we find in the bats. Now, biodiversity as a whole, we have been dependent upon the biodiversity for a long, long number of years. We have been depending upon it for food, medicine, many other products which is coming out from it. And the biodiversity which is held in the forest has been looked upon as a huge ecosystem service which we really depend upon. But when you reach a pandemic, you understand that this biodiversity can strike back. The biodiversity itself can cause you a disease, and a disease of a very high scale that the entire world goes to a lockdown. Now, how do you deal with it? What is our engagement with biodiversity? We have a large number of stories coming from Kerala on this. But before that, I should say that everybody is very proud of the Western Ghats, which is one of the 32 biodiversity hotspots across the globe. Normally, people believe that being a biodiversity hotspot is a proud thing, is a pride of the land. But that's really wrong. When Norman Myers in 1988, when he proposed this particular concept of biodiversity hotspot in a paper published in the journal Nature, the way he defined hotspot is because of two reasons. There should be two criteria which has to be satisfied if an area has to be declared as a biodiversity hotspot. The first criteria is that that place should have 0.5% of the entire vascular plants in the globe as endemic, which means that it should be either 0.5% or more than 1500 vascular plants. Vascular plants are all big plants which has got a well-defined transport system for water, other chemicals within the plant, the xylem and the phloem vessels. When you say vascular plants, it includes all the plants of the planet except for the algae, the mosses, the lowbirds and all. So apart from that, almost all the different plants. So that particular place should have 0.5% of the entire global biodiversity as endemic. So it means that those plants, more than 1500 plants in that particular area, should be found only in that area, should be endemic. Plants which are not found in other parts of the globe. This is the first criteria. And the second criteria is that that area should have lost 70% of its primary vegetation. So these are the two important criteria to define a biodiversity hotspot. So when you say that biodiversity, Western Ghats is a biodiversity hotspot, it means two things. One, Western Ghats has got more than 1500 plants which are found nowhere else in the world. That's the first thing. And the second thing is that Western Ghats has lost 70% of its primary vegetation. So these are the two things. So being a biodiversity hotspot is not just a thing to be proud of. It is also a thing to be really concerned about. Now, how have been we dealing with the biodiversity around? We have been for the past many years. We know that the human wildlife conflict is going tremendously high. Large amount of conflicts are coming up. The number of cases in 2018 was just around 6,000. It crossed over to more than 7,200 in a couple of years. The number of human-tiger conflict had gone in a 2 years' time. It has gone from 95 to more than 300. So large number of negative interactions happen between human beings and wildlife. And the compensation paid by the forest department is running into many lakhs. It has crossed 1,000 lakhs in a span of 2 years between 2018 and 19. So, sorry, 2016 and 18 in the 2 year period. So the money is going up, and the forest department is really concerned that this is an issue which can really consume the whole department. Large amount of money is given as compensation for wildlife killing domestic animals or human beings. Now, how did this story evolve? One interesting book on human-wildlife interaction was written by a person called Shivdasa Menon in the early 90s. Around 1920 to 1930 is the period in which the book is concerned about. And he tells about the story when he was a hunter by himself. He used to go for hunting. An interesting story which he narrates is his travel in a jeep along with his friends. They were moving and three elephants started to chase them. They drove it for some time and then the elephants went back. They just drove it further and they escaped. But what is more interesting is that this incident happened between the city of Calicut and a town called Farooq. Between Calicut and Farooq is the place where this incident happened. We can never ever imagine elephants, wild elephants, being in that area right now. But the entire area has been urbanized. Elephants have been pushed to small pockets in either the Nilambur forest or the Wayanad forest. And essentially what the book tries to say is that the home range of elephants have become extremely small. And when they come out of that place, we call it a big conflict. Now we have conflict with tiger, we have conflict with elephants, and elephants, the behavior has really changed. We have seen a situation where exclusive male gangs are coming out from the forest. There were three elephants which came out, which was a big furore at that point of time. Then came another group with five male elephants. They spent nearly 40 days out in the non-forest areas, creating big panic. They didn't destroy anything, they just moved around, had nice bath in the river, went back. But all this creates big problems. And interestingly, there had been a large amount of protests from the people, side of the people against these incidences. Like for example, there was in Wayanad, small school kids were out in the street with placards saying that we don't want a tiger. Now tiger, its ecological importance is very well known. It's a top predator. It is concerned because if the tiger is safe, it is assumed that all the organisms are safe in the forest. How could the children say so? The children were out in the streets protesting because of human wildlife conflict in Wayanad. We have interesting cases from Kerala on the other side also. There's a place called Mangalavanam in the heart of Kochi city. It's a mangrove forest, a small patch of mangrove forest. Long back, there was a study in the mangrove area done by Dr. Jason and Dr. Isa, wherein they located nearly 42 species of birds there in that small area. There were large number of nests there. The number of nests go up to nearly 239 in the month of May. It was a small area, and during that study, there were large number of nests over there. A small area packed with birds. It is the backwaters on one side, terrestrial area on the other side. So it was an ecotone where large number of species were there. Now what is interesting is that at that point of time, when they reported it, there was a large amount of human disturbance happening around. There was a railway terminus where the goods train used to come up and the materials were downloaded. So there would be lorries queued up near the Mangalavanam, and there would be hectic activity day and night. There would be unloading happening. There will be tea shops around, and the construction of the High Court of Kerala was being done on the other side. Large amount of disturbance, and it was noted that disturbance is really affecting the birds in the Mangalavanam in a bad way. But what is interesting is that after a long number of years, that the railway terminus was closed. There was no activity there. There was no lorries, no porters, no tea people. The construction of the High Court is complete. There is no disturbance from that place also. But at the same time, the entire nesting activity in the Mangalavanam stopped. What essentially happened was that the big activity of human beings was a big protective element for the birds. They were safe out there. They were not poached because they were safe when people are around. You can see it all across Kerala. You go to a railway station, you go to a bus stand, the trees there will be the places where the birds will be roosting at night. They will not be roosting at a far away tree which is standing all alone without any human activity. They all crowd to the place to rose because they feel safe when the people are out. So there are both ways in which the animals, it is not to say that people move out and animals are safe. They are all, man is interacting with the animals in a positive and negative ways. There's a large number of fingeries also. And how do we go about it? There's one group of people who lives in Kerala who had never been having any major problem with this sort of interactions. And they are the indigenous people of Kerala. One of the major problems is that those indigenous people have never cried out that their cattle has been lifted or they have got a damage to their property because of human-wildlife conflict. They are able to live with biodiversity. And that's a very important term, how to live with biodiversity. And that is one trade which the new generation is fast forgetting. The best example is the mosquito. The mosquito, you have a wall around your house, you have a tiled up space around your home, you have closed windows and doors, but then you have mosquitoes inside. Now this is a way in which some species respond to our developmental activities. We call them the R-selected species in biology, which is against the K-selected species, which are others. The R-selected species are those species which can increase their population in a very fast way. They reproduce very fast and they produce large number of offsprings. Their body size will be normally small. And the K-selected species, on the other hand, produce small number of offsprings. But then they will have a very high amount of parental care. Their lifespan will be much more. So whenever there's a disturbance, the R-selected species increase in their number. They can immediately respond to change. And one species which does that is the wild boar. And the wild boars can adapt very fast and they can increase their numbers extremely fast than many other species. And that's the reason why wild boar had been a major problem in many parts of Kerala. And interestingly, wild boar case brings us to a situation where the question of how to govern a particular landscape comes in. We had done a study in the northern part of Kerala, in the border between Kannur and Kasaragod districts, wherein where we took a small river, a river which is just 31 kilometers long, called the Kavai River, which originates from the midland laterites of Kerala and empties to the Kavai backwaters, which empties to the Arabian Sea. So the entire river basin was studied by us. Basically, we were looking at what type of land use changes are happening over there over a period of 3 decades, and what are the changes which we are expecting. And we were trying to identify the critical habitats which are needed to sustain our life over there. Many interesting results came up. It was Dr. Alex who did that study. And we could identify very high level of biodiversity. It is not a it's a non-forest area. There was no natural forest around. But we could identify nearly 962 different types of flowering plants, 140 species of butterflies, 538 species of moths, 23 species of grasshoppers, 163 species of spiders, 209 species of birds, and 42 species of macrofungi. This is the level of biodiversity you find outside forest in Kerala. So it has got a very high biodiversity there. Now we looked at what are the critical habitats over there. This need to be sustained so as to have water in the area to maintain this biodiversity, which is really helpful for the pollination of agriculture crops, dispersal of seeds, for many other purposes, including medicines. And we found that there are several critical ecosystems. Critical ecosystems, which means that if that ecosystem is gone, that is going to affect a larger area. Ecosystem services will be affected for a large space. It includes the sacred grooves, the kanams. Kanams are small grooves where no worship happens. The difference between sacred groove and kanam is that in sacred groove there will be worshipping a deity, but not in a kanam. Then the laterite exposed areas, the riverine vegetation. There are small patches of riverine vegetation which found over there. the Kunian wetlands, which is extremely important for a large number of wetland birds, and kudri among the agriculture crops. Kudri are small heaps of soil in which semi-natural vegetation come up amidst agriculture areas, where many of the pest controlling species like the bats, the owls, the rodents all reside. Now, all these critical ecosystems together form around 7.5% of the total river basin, and we found that this area has to be conserved at any cost so as to maintain the ecosystem services around. But how can that happen? How does it work out in the field? There is absolutely no legal protection for these critical habitats right now. Which brings us into a question of what would be the relationship between science and governance in the land. Scientific efforts, research has brought up large amount of information from across the landscape. There are still new species being discovered. There's a large number of flowering plants identified, even trees newly described. There's a large number of species of frogs, not just species, even genus of frogs has been identified from the Western Ghats. Now, when that happens, how does it influence the process of governance of the land? Is there any specific mechanism? This was one important question which the researchers were really concerned about, which was answered in 2011 by the publication of the Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report, which was commissioned by the Ministry of Environment and Forest, Government of India. What that report tried to say was about a methodology on how to manage a big landscape. In a big landscape like the Western Ghat area, all spaces are not equal. There are some very sloppy terrains, midlands are there, shores are there. There's different ways in which people engage with nature there. Now, the Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report came up with a methodology by which we can say that which is the areas which are to be conserved, which has to be the area where development can happen, and what are the ways and means in which it can be organized. That report came out in 2011, and that was the only one way in which we could find that science can influence the governance process which is happening. And that report was not implemented. It was succeeded by another report called the High Power Western Ghat High Level Working Group report, headed by Dr. Kasturi Rangan. But what essentially happened was that there was a huge outcry against the report, which was really trying to make sense out of living in an extremely ecologically sensitive landscape. I'll just cite one instance before I close this talk. It is about the wild boar, which we told earlier. Normally, the discussions which happened in Kerala suggested that the Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report is a romantic report, which has got nothing to do with empirical studies. But it was, on the other hand, it was a report which had gone into almost all the studies which has happened in Western Ghats while the report was being made. And one of the recommendations was quite interesting in the report is to reduce the number of wild boars wherever the problem is quite on the high. And last month or so, the Kerala government gave an order to do that. Very gradually, the Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report is being implemented in bits and pieces, because that's the only way out. While we are moving forward, we will have to implement more and more of the provisions which is there in the Western Ghat Ecology Panel report, and that's the only way out, because that's the only scientific methodology which we have at the moment to protect our nature around us. And living with nature is something very important in the time of pandemic. What essentially we try to do, we need to do, is to stop challenging any other species living over here. Because all the species occupy the same space, and they also have needs. And when we get into large areas, it can get into conflict. And we need to make sure that the conflict doesn't happen and the life of no single species is challenged. This is an extremely important thing which has to be taken into consideration when we move forward. That brings us into directly into what type of governance is happening in the land. In the pandemic period, we found that the many countries have got totally different governance systems, and we came to know, get an opportunity to compare the governance systems on how efficient they are in controlling a big issue like the pandemic. Some governance systems completely failed, some others were surviving, and Kerala happens to be one of the places where we could erect a better management strategy for this pandemic. With all those good things which we have, there's another interesting thing which has happened during the pandemic. One is that we had a major industrial disaster in Visakhapatnam in India. We had major setbacks by way of in a river called Periyar in Kerala, where large amount of effluents were thrown into the river from the industrial estates. And also, interestingly, we had the mining activity opened up in Kerala during when all the other sectors were under lockdown. We had this granite mining going on, and there was special permission given to them for doing that. At the national level, it is much more worse. The stories which come from Arunachal Pradesh says that large amount of national parks have been let apart from mining. Now, this is where we need to look at, have a fresh look at the governance structures. Our democracy right now has to be rethought as how deep it is. What the Western Ghat ecology expert panel tried to say is that everybody living over here would have to have a say on what's happening around him, whether that's going to affect that particular person. He or she has to have a say in it. The large number of indigenous people in Kerala completely cut off from the decision making process, which impacts them. Like in the 2019 floods, people displaced during the 2019 floods are still in the camps. They were not able to go back because of adequate facilities. Now there's a serious deficit which we find over here, where the democracy has to happen much more serious at the local level. The Western Ghat ecology panel, still I rely on it as a basic model from which we can start off. Basically, the report suggested that the Grama Sabha has to be empowered, and the Grama Sabha should have the decision making powers to on everything happening within that area. This is the only way in which we can engage a better engagement with nature around us and with the biodiversity. It's a long road to that, and Kerala can go that distance, basically because they have instances where we have been challenged and we have been responding fast, and most of our resources were now being used on a pandemic which started off just because we challenged nature. And we cannot think that this is something which has originated from China, because we had the similar experience a few years before right in Kerala at a place called Kozhikode when we had the Nipah outbreak. Nipah virus also came from bats, infected people, extremely dangerous. We lost life because of that. This year also, we lost life because of Kaisanu disease in Wayanad, a disease which is transmitted from the monkeys to human beings through the ticks which bite monkeys and human beings. So the nature around is bountiful, but at the same time it can challenge us. It can strike back when we challenge them. So this is the problem against which we need to build up democratic solutions. Thank you.